evening, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of Monash University Malaysia, I would like to welcome you to the first public lecture of 2016 in the Sir John Monash Distinguished Public Lecture Series. Now, this lecture series is inspired by the philosophy and the life of service of Sir John Monash, one of Australia's finest. A distinguished citizen, scholar, and teacher, Sir John Monash believed that education should be harnessed to improve one's abilities in order that one may serve the whole community, to use his own words. And it is in that spirit that this public lecture series is convened by Monash University Malaysia. The lectures under this series cover a wide range of contemporary and interdisciplinary topics presented by public intellectuals, by policymakers, corporate leaders, and scholars, all leading experts in their field and who have made a significant impact to the community at large. Through the exchange of ideas, through new ways of looking at existing issues and problems, and through open discussion, the public lecture series is intended to follow in the tradition sparked by Sir John Monash to engage and work to the benefit of the wider community. And there is no better person to start us off in the 2016 lecture series than Dr. Jomo Kwame Sundaram. We are indeed delighted to have him with us this evening to speak on the topic, Trans-Pacific Partnership, Winners and Losers. This is a highly topical subject, one that is of considerable public interest, and that's evident from this incredible turnout on a weekday in a place noted for its very busy traffic. But I also believe that many of you are here today because of the speaker himself. It is also a controversial subject, and Jomo himself has been one of those who has raised probing questions about the TPPA, characterized as the 21st century model for economic cooperation agreements to come. In raising the often hidden or ignored distributional question of winners and losers, Jomo is carrying on a long scholarly tradition and global public service focused on the pressing problems of development, poverty, and inequality. Dr. Jomo Kwame Sundaram was born in Penang, Malaysia. He studied at the renowned Penang Free School and the Royal Military College, and then proceeded to undergraduate studies at Yale and completed his PhD at Harvard. He has taught in Malaysia and abroad, at USM, at Harvard, at Yale, and UKM. But he spent most of his academic career from 1982 to 2004 at University of Malaya, where he was professor in the Department of Applied Economics in the Faculty of Economics and Administration. He left a distinguished academic career at University of Malaya for a decade of global public service at the United Nations, where he served as Assistant Secretary General working on economic development. When he retired from the UN system in 2015, he returned home and currently holds the Tun Hussein On Chair in International Studies at the Institute of Strategic and International Studies in Kuala Lumpur. Jomo has published extensively over 40 years. His publications are just too numerous for me to outline here, but they all essentially challenge received wisdom on the subject of development, and they direct our attention to how global capitalism, which can work for the betterment of humanity, can also have unfortunate consequences for employment, equality, and development that we simply cannot afford to ignore or gloss over. This theme continues to resonate in his writings and talks, and will, I believe, inform his analysis of the Trans-Pacific Partnership. Please join me in extending a very warm welcome to Dr. Jomo Kwame Sundaram.
Thanks. Thank you very much for the very kind words of introduction, and thank you all for your presence on this evening. We in Malaysia have prospered because of two major imports from West Africa. One is oil palm, and the second one is cocoa, mainly in Sabah, of course. The third suggestion import I would like to bring in from West Africa is shortening of the usual salutations to everybody by saying all protocols observed. So with that, I, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, friends all, let me thank you for your presence here today. We have a very difficult subject, and the Trans-Pacific Partnership, often known in Malaysia as the Trans-Pacific Partnership Agreement, and I will use the two terms interchangeably, is like the proverbial Indian elephant, with the different blind people touching the different parts of the elephant and concluding very differently about what the elephant is about. And my own experience with the TPP is likewise. I started off being engaged mainly in the trade aspects. I was looking rather slightly suspiciously at some of the big changes, big differences in the projections which were made by different quarters about what the TPP would bring. And I got involved in it. And soon after I left the United Nations at the end of last year, got much more involved in some of the discussion and had more time to look at some of the other aspects. And quite honestly, my concerns now are not primarily about the prospective trade gains, trade-related gains, but are really about the overall impact. Because the free trade agreement aspect of the TPP is actually a relatively minor aspect in my view. I will spend a bit of time over the next few minutes challenging some of the claims which are being made. I don't claim to know exactly what is going to happen as a consequence of the TPP. I will rather focus some attention on some of the other non-trade aspects of the TPP, which are very important for us to consider before drawing some conclusions about what the TPP implies for the future of our nation. So this is not really an attempt to try to discuss the TPP and its likely impact for the entire world, but rather focused on its likely implications for Malaysia. So with that caveat, let me try to run through a fairly long presentation. I will try not to dwell on some of the technical aspects, but I'm very conscious of Professor Mahindran's presence here. He's a world-renowned expert on the computable general equilibrium models, the CGE models. And for that reason, I not only to avoid his critical scrutiny, but which I'll be happy to do this, but I think at this time of the day, on this day of the week, it's best not to go into too many methodological issues. So I'd like to spend some time discussing what the TPP is likely to imply for us. As you all know, the Malaysian Parliament approved, not only agreed to the TPP arrangement, but also, curiously, agreed to ratify the TPP, something which is not required by the Malaysian government until about 2 years from now. But the Malaysian Parliament nonetheless did so. And I think what we have had, unfortunately, is a rather under-informed discussion, partly because almost all of us, myself included, have focused on the TPP as some kind of a regional trade agreement. And I would suggest, I would put it to you that my concerns with the non-trade aspects of the TPP are probably far more serious. Let me begin with some of the illusions. These have got nothing to do with Malaysia. This is something which was presented by the United States Trade Representative's office and how TPP trade growth has been misrepresented. you will notice, I think that this is a misrepresentation, especially if you look at what happened when the Wall Street Journal, hardly a very, very much usually associated with being very pro-free trade, suggested that this is a very misleading graph, and this is what the graph should look like, okay? Because the actual gains, as you can see, are minuscule when you compare this with this, okay? So let's try to put that in perspective. Not content with one serious error of misrepresentation, let's look at this. Export growth, okay? So you have this, this was the graph presented by the USTR's office, and this is how it should look like. But regardless of whether you look at this or look at this, the point is that if you look at all the CGE modeling, because of the limitations of the model's specifications used, you find that the assumption is that if there's a big increase in exports, there will be a corresponding increase in imports. And so the trade balance remains unchanged. Okay? This is a requirement of the particular methodology used. Okay? But you would never get a sense of it. You would think that there's simply a big increase in exports without a corresponding increase in imports. Now, I'm not suggesting that estimating losses and gains is a very easy task. And I think it is very important to remember that it is a very challenging task by any standards, let alone when you are working under political or other constraints. I think what we have with the CGE models which have been used are certain assumptions which are being used in the modeling, which prevent you from looking at certain aspects. Okay, so it's very important, therefore, if you're interested in looking at how it affects people, that you might want to look at whether there are changes in real incomes. You might want to look at how it affects employment, because jobs do matter. You may also want to look at how it might affect inequality. So these were the questions we came to. So we started off these are the questions we came to, and I'll come back to this in a moment, okay? So let me just emphasize what some of my concerns are, which will become more apparent as I proceed later. And I think it is extremely important if the country is going to develop, that a government is appropriately interventionist in order to accelerate the development process. There is no government in the world, almost by definition, there's no government in the world which is completely laissez-faire. The closest might have been the Hong Kong government. But I can assure you even that the Hong Kong authorities do play an important role, as was very evident, for example, in 1998, as you can hear, for example, when Tan Sri Andrew Sheng was very much involved in managing the crisis. The point I'd like to make here in this connection is that once you lock in what the country can do, you are irreversibly setting the country on a particular course. Social scientists like to call this path dependence, okay? But one has to look at the consequences. And therefore, when they say that 18 sets of laws in this country have to be amended to comply with the TPP, this is not a trivial matter. It will set the country on a particular course, and that will seriously limit the range of options available. And this, I think, is a matter which we need to think about. We obviously need to think about what the implications, not only of those specific laws, but the overall effect of these laws interacting with one another are likely to be. One should also remember that there is a huge problem in many of these agreements. You may agree on something at a particular point in time, assuming that it is the best thing for you to do, and then later on regret the decision made. Let me give you a simple example. In the late 1980s and the early 1990s, there was a great deal of discussion over something called the Agreement on Agriculture. This was part of a round of multilateral trade negotiations called the Uruguay Round, okay, because it started in Punta del Este in Uruguay. And as a consequence of these negotiations, an agreement on agriculture was agreed to. Now, at that time, there were not very many developing countries who were involved in that negotiation. The main developing country, which was doing much of the negotiation on behalf of developing countries, was India. Okay? And this was taking place after about four decades of declining food prices. After the Second World War, there was a decline in food prices, partly because of the success of the so-called Green Revolution in boosting the yield of food production. So as a consequence of big increases in production, no monopolistic power on the part of the producers, of the suppliers. So you had a situation where what you might describe as the economic surplus was largely captured by consumers in the form of cheaper prices. So you had a steady decline in the prices of rice, of wheat, and of maize or corn after the Second World War. This was a steady decline. And this situation continued after the end of the Uruguay Round negotiations. Unfortunately, about a decade ago, the situation changed radically for a whole variety of reasons. Some of the impacts of extreme climate conditions, for example, there was a decade-long drought in Australia. There have been shorter episodes in many other parts of the world. There is now what is called an arid zone in Central America. All this has had tremendous effects. The frequency of El Nino and La Nina has become greater. So the consequence of all these effects has been that combined with the decision by the North Atlantic economic powers, the United States on the one hand and Europe on the other hand, to promote biofuels, resulted in the elevation of the price of maize in the case of the US and those sources of vegetable oils in the case of Europe. Okay, so the result of all this was that you had an increase in the price of maize, and this in turn, together with a great deal of financial speculation which was taking place, all this had the effect of raising food prices from around 2006 or so, and I think we felt it most around 2008 when there was a spike even in the price of rice. Now you have to remember that rice is very thinly traded, meaning that only about 6% of total rice in the world is actually traded on markets. Most rice is sold within the country or transacted on the basis of long-term contracts. Okay, so even despite that fact, we've had a big elevation, and that was the time when the Malaysian government, the agriculture minister at that time, pledged to make Malaysia 100% self-sufficient. I'm not sure that was an appropriate response, but you can imagine the context and the need to appear to be responsive. This also had, in the meantime, India was trying to ensure that there would be no more hunger in India. So it undertook a number of measures, including most recently in 2013, something called the Food Security Act, which is now basically in conflict with the Agreement on Agriculture. So the point I'm trying to make is that what seemed to make sense in an earlier period of declining food prices no longer makes sense when prices have begun to go up. So that's why you don't want to get locked into a situation, to locked into certain commitments which can later on change, later on have negative consequences when the situation changes. And this, unfortunately, is what the kind of situation we are getting ourselves into. Now, let me go into looking at the trade gains. Now, most of the gains from trade associated with the TPPA, which you will hear about, are results from the Peterson Institute. The Peterson Institute used to be called the Institute of International Economics. It was set up by the former Deputy Secretary of the Treasury, Fred Bergsten, many years ago. Peter Peterson put in a lot of money, and now it's named after him. Okay, and it's known, this is nothing controversial, it's known as a cheerleader of globalization. Okay, so the Peterson Institute commissioned, or actually Professor Petrie from Brandeis University, Christopher Plummer, and Mr. Jai, the three who has been doing some work on CGE modeling, the three of them collaborated. They produced a report in the year 2012 trying to anticipate the results. Similar, more recently, they've come up with another report 2 months ago. And also at the same time, you'll find that the second report has been used by the World Bank, but incredibly, the World Bank claims the growth gains are more than double what the second Peterson Institute report claims. Okay, I'll come to the details later. They all use something called, as I mentioned earlier, CGE models, and they all basically assume three important things which are important for a consideration of the issues. One, they assume full employment. Okay. Two, they assume no change in the trade balance, no change in the fiscal balance, okay, the budget, basically. Now, then there are also a lot of things which are assumed for purposes of the modeling, which are also not in the deal, okay? So, this is inevitable, okay? If I'm not criticizing the people, you know, when you're doing your work, you try to do the best you can given the information you have available. That's no big deal. Now, very, very importantly, there's also another study done by something called the Economic Research Service of the U.S. Department of Agriculture. It is the only research service within the U.S. government. There is something, of course, called the Congressional Budget Office, but they don't do similar type of research. And so the ERS is basically the only official U.S. government study. Okay, they also use a CGE model. Now, incredibly, all these studies come to very, very different results. USDA ERS finds that you will have, after 10 years, total growth of 0.1 of 1%. Okay, 0.1 of 1%, not per annum. Okay, after 10 years. So you basically, to get the per annum thing is about 0.01. Okay, that's what, you know. Now, most people would think this is nothing to shout about. Okay? And this is why nobody talks about it. Okay? Nobody talks about it. Even the US government doesn't talk about it when it tries to make the case for the TPP. This is the situation in which we're in. I'll come to the other findings in a minute. Okay? So, what did the Peterson Institute find? They claim after 10 years, this is 2012 study, after 10 years, you will have total growth of 0.4. Okay, how do they get a higher figure? I'll come to that in a minute. In the latest version, they say that after 15 years, not 10 years, after 15 years, you'll get additional growth, of 0.5 after 15 years. So you do your little arithmetic, don't have to do the compound interest rate and so on and so forth, and you can see how paltry it is. Okay. Now, how did they, and then, oh yeah, and then the World Bank. Okay, we've just, Malaysian government has just paid a lot of money to have a World Bank office here. The World Bank uses the same study as the Peterson Institute, and I don't know how they come to a number which is more than double. So 0.5 was the new figure after 15 years, and the World Bank comes up with 1.1. Okay? Now, you can download it if you're interested. The Global Monitoring Report, January 2016. Okay? To be fair to the bank, they admit that there are many problems with this whole exercise, but they never tell you why. And it's curious because it is the same author. Two of the authors are the same. They never tell you why their results are double the results they also published in January. Okay? So you have two reports in January from the same authors publishing two figures which are so different. Okay? Now, don't ask me any questions on this because I cannot tell you the answer. Okay? But I think the more important point is why you have much higher figures compared to the 0.1 of the ERS. And the main reason is, the main reasons are twofold. Number one, you have something called NTMs, non-trade measures, okay? And basically, in some, I'm looking at Professor Mahindran because he will cringe at how some of the things they have done. They basically attribute growth to all kinds of things. Okay, let me give you a simple example. You extend the length of patents. You prevent, you limit the possibility of producing generic drugs, and so on and so forth. Okay. Now, what would this mean? This would probably mean that most of us would have to pay more for those drugs, okay? And the Malaysian government would have to pay more to buy those drugs, okay? Now, how do you think they model this into them, they put this into their model? It's a big increase in trade in services, okay? So, I mean, with this kind of methodology, you know, you can imagine why I've been so critical, dubious about how they come to all the other results. And I can, and if you look at their work, you will find that this is how they proceed. It's not only them; the Malaysian version of it is not very different. Okay, there are some differences, but not fundamentally different. Okay, so basically, over 90% comes from these NTMs directly as well as indirectly in the form of increased foreign direct investment. So they anticipate a big increase in foreign direct investment. Okay? Coming, and this is where the growth comes from. Okay? So instead of Malaysian investors investing in Malaysia, Australian investors investing in Australia, US investors investing in the US, US investors will invest in Australia, Australian investors will invest in Malaysia, Malaysian investors are going to invest in the US. So be prepared. Okay? This is what basically is assumed. Okay? What is the empirical basis for it in terms of past historical trends? Nope. Forget about it. If you look at NAFTA, for example, the North American Free Trade Area, how many Mexican investments are there in the US and Canada? Not significant. And so on and so forth. Okay, so not based on empirical stuff. Dubious justification for their methodology, dubious specifications, and so on and so forth. So this is how, that's why I say beware. Beware of how you get growth. Because you can all produce growth, you know. It's like these so-called God men in India. You know, you can materialize ash and put them on and bless their followers and so on and so forth. But this is supposed to be economics. This is not meta-economics, okay? So this is what we need to deal with. So my little bit of advice is we should be a bit more serious about how we try to do cost-benefit analysis. Do not claim these exaggerated benefits from NTMs, and basically take very seriously whether there is going to be any reductions in tariffs, and you will find that there won't be all that many reductions in tariffs because, let's face it, Malaysia is quite has been an open economy. The US has been an open economy also, especially in the last five decades or so. So you don't expect much in terms of any change. The remaining problems are due to what are called non-tariff barriers, okay? If there's a campaign against, let us say, palm oil in another country, or there's, you know, these are the kinds of barriers which exist, and the TPPA is basically quite silent about this. So we basically need to look very, very carefully at these costs, because if you look at a cost, or worse still, you misrepresent a cost as a benefit, of course you can get a lot of benefits, okay? But you have to ask yourself whether or not those so-called benefits are real benefits or whether they are cost posing as benefits. So let us be very clear. There is very, very little increase in growth. You can have a big increase in trade, but a big increase in trade in and of itself does not necessarily generate growth. You have to look very specifically at what it is, what is entailed in the increase in trade, to see whether or not it results in greater growth. And beyond that, of course, you have to look much more carefully to see who exactly benefits from that growth, if there is growth. Okay, who benefits? People in certain sectors? Or is it the employers, the employees, and so on and so forth? These are some of the what people would call distributional issues which are relevant for consideration. So I put it to you that, in fact, there will be benefits, but we should stop thinking about benefits in terms of simply in terms of one country benefiting at the expense of another country. I think there will be some benefits, clearly, especially for Vietnam, and I'll come back to this question later. Okay? But for the rest of us, I'm not sure there are benefits in terms of country as a whole benefiting. But when we look at particular parts of the country or particular groups in the country, there may well be benefits. And so I think when we are looking at the question of winners and losers, don't think about countries or national economies. Think much more carefully about sectors as well as interest groups in those sectors. Now, I mentioned to you that I got involved before I came back to Malaysia, and my involvement is actually slightly remote. Okay, when I first joined the UN, and especially from around 2007 or so, I was involved in developing an alternative macroeconomic model for the UN. We were basically unhappy with the fact that most of the macroeconomic modeling done by the IMF at that time, OECD, and so on and so forth, was mainly inspired by more recent economic thinking. It was not very much inspired by the Keynesian thinking, which was associated not only with the early years of the UN, but it was also very much associated with a different perspective. Now, at first, there was very little support for this. But when the 2008 financial crisis hit, we suddenly found ourselves in great demand. And unfortunately, there were very few resources which were available to us, but we persevered and we developed this model. And most of the credit for it has to go to colleagues of mine. Rather, I had only a role in sort of being a bit of a small-time patron for this. Now, then more recently, from around 2014, with a lot of talk about the TTIP, Transatlantic Trade and Investment Pact involving the US and EU. Okay, so we started looking at that, and we started looking at the TPPA. And that the TTIP paper was published, was done by one of our younger members of our group, and then later he was subjected to a lot of criticism, so I got and my other colleagues also got much more involved in the second paper. So the second paper is the one on the TPPA. And I have to be very, very clear, we didn't do our own trade modeling work. So you'll find a lot of people criticizing us for, you know, oh, the global policy model is not a trade model and so on. We are the first to admit it's not a trade model. We are the first to admit that it is meant to be a macroeconomic model, and what we try to do with that macroeconomic model is to look at the implications of that growth in trade. So we accepted the Peterson Institute's findings. We accepted their results. We were skeptical for the reasons I have tried to hint at earlier, but we accepted those results, and then we tried to look at what would happen if you relax the assumption. Once you have a different view about, you don't no longer assume full employment, you no longer assume an unchanging trade balance and unchanging fiscal balance. And the result was basically we found that after 10 years, there would probably be something less than, slightly under 800,000 jobs lost, of which about 500,000 would be in the US alone. Frankly, these are not huge numbers, okay? These are not huge numbers, especially for the US. And for Malaysia, it's very difficult to tell, okay, how big they are. There would be a big increase in employment probably in Vietnam, but for other countries, probably quite negligible consequences. And what we did find also is that greater trade is likely to put downward pressure on wages. There would be a race to the bottom, which tends to be the consequence of free trade groupings, and this would put downward pressure. So, for example, we may think we are very good at producing, I mean, when Malaysia went into a cocoa production in the 1980s, by the end of the 1980s, Malaysian cocoa was responsible for bringing down the world price of cocoa from the beginning of the 1980s by about 30%. Okay? Fortunately for the West Africans and the Latin Americans, Malaysian cocoa happens to be very bitter. But most cocoa is no longer used for chocolate, contrary to what you might think. Most cocoa is actually used for cosmetics. Okay? So there was a, you know, nobody is going to eat the cosmetics they use on there. So, you know, there's a lot of demand for that cocoa butter. Okay? Now, from the late 1980s into the 1990s, Vietnam did the similar thing. Vietnam increased its production of, I'm not sure whether it's Robusta or Arabica coffee. Okay? But within a decade, they had brought the price of coffee, the world price of coffee, down by about 35%, if I remember correctly. Okay, a drastic drop. So the Africans and others were all cursing the Vietnamese as they had been cursing the Malaysians before that. Okay, but the result of it is in the form of what we call, economists would call, a consumer surplus. Okay, lower prices of coffee. It's not necessarily, just because you increase productivity, it doesn't necessarily mean that productivity would accrue to the producers. Okay, so this is basically the kind of questions we were asking. And we also found that there would be about income losses in the US of about 0.5% over a decade, okay? So not a huge amount. And in Japan of about 0.1% over, again, a decade. Now, as you all know, Japan is having has a huge problem with the demographic, you can't call it a dividend, you can, the demographic, the demographic profile the country has. So losing jobs in Japan is not a matter of concern. They already expect to lose jobs, okay? So it's no big deal for Japan. But for the US, it's obviously of greater concern, okay? And we tried to look at some of the other macro distributional effects, and I won't get into that all that right now because I want to move on as quickly as I can to the other aspects of the TPPA. What I hope to have convinced you so far is that the TPPA is negligibly about trade liberalization. The consequences are quite mixed, but it's negligible. Okay? So what then are we, can you expect from the TPPA? Why should you all be concerned? And basically, my argument is that the TPPA does not address the major problems which we currently face. Okay? It does not fundamentally address the major problems which we currently face as far as trade is concerned. But also, very, very importantly, we are going to face a set of rules. Okay? A set of rules which are largely driven by some of the most powerful global corporations. And this is what we need to be concerned about. And they will intrude, as I tried to suggest earlier, on how governments can operate if and when they choose to operate in the public interest and the national interest. You cannot assume that governments necessarily do that. We like to think that governments do that. But if and when they do that, this is what should be the case. They will be constrained. So this is why I am very concerned. And you will find that the rights of investors will be greatly increased. Intellectual property rights will be greatly strengthened. The ability of governments to regulate in the public interest, in the national interest, will be compromised. Let me begin with intellectual property rights. My biggest concern here, of course, is with pharmaceutical drugs. And the TPPA basically goes far more into the implications for pharmaceutical drugs than what you find in TRIPS. TRIPS are trade-related intellectual property rights, which is the part of the WTO agreement which deals with intellectual property rights. In fact, there has long been an organization called WIPO, the World Intellectual Property Organization, but it has had very little teeth and hence has been of very little interest to major transnational corporations. But through the WTO, they have been able to introduce a number of things. And many countries, especially developing countries, fought very hard for what is called a public health exception. And basically, that public health exception will be compromised very, very seriously by the TPPA. So what do the provisions do? They basically extend the length of the patent, the period when these super royalties can be extracted. They keep cheaper generics off the market. I don't know how many of you, for example, take drugs on a regular basis, but I, for example, have been taking statins, And if not for the fact for the availability of generics from India, now from Bangladesh and from elsewhere, the price of statins would be much, much higher and really unaffordable. As you know, the word statin refers to tin. And Malaysia used to be a tin producer, but, you know, there's a long distance between extracting tin from the ground and what we consume to deal with cholesterol levels and so on and so forth. And also, there are clauses which deal with the availability of similar new medicines. So basically, you can anticipate a much higher cost. That's why it was disingenuous for people to talk, to say, oh, there won't be any significant impact on the cost of on public health, there won't be any significant impact on the cost of medicines and so on forth, so forth. Another very, very serious concern is something called the investor-state dispute settlement. This greatly strengthens the rights of foreign investors. And basically, it means that when a foreign investor is not happy with the decision of a government policy decision or a regulatory decision, that investor can go to an arbitration panel, which is basically a private arbitration panel, and basically try to secure their interests. Now, some of you may have heard of the recent case in Australia involving tobacco. Okay, you know that Malaysian government has now these photographs on tobacco wrappers, which basically I think Australia pioneered. So the leading companies leading tobacco companies sued a number of governments, including the Australian government and the Uruguayan government, over this. Now, in a recent decision, the Australian, Supreme Court in Australia, ruled against the tobacco company, okay? But there's no guarantee but in a private arbitration panel, it would not be the Supreme Court ruling. A Supreme Court ruling would have no effect, okay? It would be basically left to the ISDS. Now, how many people are involved in ISDS? There is a community of less than 250 lawyers, I'm told, who are involved in ISDS, and they basically take turns. Okay, sometimes they are on the panel, sometimes they are on one side or the other side. They basically take turns doing this kind of work. And there are now over 3,000 bilateral investment treaties, and these decisions are basically binding. You know, if you lose a case in the High Court, you can appeal to the Supreme Court or to the Appeals Court. In this case, there's no further recourse. A decision made is binding. And you cannot say, oh, this is in the national interest. That is not of interest to the arbitration panel. You cannot say that this is in the public interest. Okay? Let me give you a simple example. We have the most popular herbicide use in this country, and you have to remember that Malaysia still is very, very heavily dependent on agricultural products and exports. The most popular herbicide in this country has been declared carcinogenic by the WHO, the World Health Organization, some years ago. Okay? WikiLeaks leaked out the information that the U.S. Department of Agriculture suspected as much way back in the 1970s. This information was basically suppressed. Okay, so in effect, the sale of those those chemicals has been basically causing a lot of problems, including cancers, for decades, not only in this country, throughout the world. Now, what would happen? So the consequence is that you also have a lot of people who are probably suffering from cancers, who, when they learn about this, may well try to take legal action. Okay? Under Malaysian law, they are entitled to some rudimentary health services. They can go and go to a third class ward in a public hospital. Okay. Now, if Malaysia were to ban that chemical, what would be the effect? That company could go to a panel, successfully probably sue the Malaysian government for lost profits, which is precisely what TransCanada is now doing vis-a-vis the US government, because TransCanada claims that it has put in some money, and now the pipeline, which is supposed to bring, I think, shale from Canada to Louisiana, has been called off. Okay. But just go back to the Malaysian example. So you will have, as a consequence of this, governments who are going to be intimidated and not act in the public interest. Okay? Because they face the prospects of multi-billion dollar suits from lost investments. The New Zealanders have called this regulatory chill. Okay? Basically, governments will be intimidated from acting in the public interest, in the national interest, because of fear from undertaking what is expected of them by the public, by you and I. So this will have huge implications. Do we need this legislation? People say, oh, we still have to protect the investors. Well, on Monday, when the World Bank office was being opened, I happened to sit next to somebody from the World Bank group who happens to be the representative of MIGA, the Multilateral Investment Guarantee Agency. Okay? That's what they are set up for. You can buy private insurance, or you can buy insurance from the World Bank. There are sufficient protections available now, you know, besides international contract law. Okay? There is no need for the ISDS. But unfortunately, we are happily signing on to something which has unfathomable consequences, because it's very difficult. If I say something or you say something, you say, you're exaggerating. But, you know, how do you know that you're exaggerating? How do we know for sure? It's very difficult to anticipate something which we consider perfectly safe today may turn out to be toxic when further tests are done. So this is very important. Let me quickly move to the example of textiles. The example of textiles, it's presented in the TPPA, in the cost-benefit analysis commissioned by the Malaysian government as the great Malaysian hope. Of the five sectors which they chose, and now 10 sectors, the greatest growth is supposed to come from textiles. What they mean really is what are called garments, okay? Because when you look at the industrial classification, it's broken into textiles. So basically, garments, about 30 years ago, I don't know whether any of those students are still around, students of mine did some work and they found that, contrary to what everybody thought, the sector with the most employees was actually garments, more than electronic and electrical products. Okay, that time I think it was about 160,000 in electronics and 200,000 in garments. Okay, what is the number today? Under 30,000. And the reason for this is very simple. Even China is giving up garments. Okay? Labor costs are going up in China. People don't produce garments in China. They're moving to Vietnam, and soon they will move from Vietnam to places like Bangladesh. So, yes, of course we can. I remember about 20 years ago, another student of mine did a study in Seberang Perai, and she found that there was tremendous tension on the in the factory community, in the community around the factory, between the men in the community and the Bangladeshi workers, because the workers who were working in the factory were Malay women and Bangladeshi men. Okay? And you can imagine the interpersonal dynamics which are going on. So the result was that there was a great deal of violence. You know, these Bangladeshi guys would get beaten up and so on and so forth. You know, who asked you to, why did you look at her? And, you know, this kind of thing. And this was the kind of thing which was going on. So rather than bring Bangladeshi men here, we now have those same producers, those same suppliers, now based in Dhaka, in Chittagong, and elsewhere. Okay? This is what has happened. I mean, this is globalization, right? So to expect that this whole trend is going to be reversed. Now, there is one more thing which needs to be considered. There is something called the yarn forward rule in the TPPA. What is the yarn forward rule? The yarn forward rule is basically you have to use yarn from a TPPA source country in order to qualify for the lower tariff. If you don't use yarn from within that country, then you don't qualify. So what it basically means is that you have to use yarn from the US or from Japan, okay? Because I don't think any of the other TPP countries are significant yarn producers, okay? Now what does, and where does most of the remaining garments in Malaysia and Vietnam come from? Despite all the problems between Vietnam and China, most of the yarn comes from China. There's also yarn coming from Indonesia and a number of other countries. But there is very little yarn is used from the US or Japan. So this is a problem. You know, you cannot expect people to start using yarn just to qualify under something when the yarn is so much more expensive as these yarns tend to be. I'm not saying there are of course some uniquely Japanese and American yarns. I mean, for example, what is used to make Uniqlo, okay? If you don't know what it is, don't bother. It's not worth it. Okay, so I think all this is a long and roundabout way of saying that we need to accelerate development. Malaysia has been doing pretty dismally for the last two decades, ever since the Asian crisis. We have not really gotten out of that. And what needs to be done is, so the choice is not simply TPP or no TPP. We have other options. But you can reduce it all down to a TPP or no TPP situation by eliminating all those other options. That is what is actually going to happen over the next couple of years, I'm afraid. So I think we have to think very carefully. I promised that I would keep my thing, my presentation, to less than an hour, so I'm running out of time. So let me just run through the last couple of slides. I think it appears to most observers that the main motives for having the TPPA are political. Okay, I think this, let's face it, of the Asian countries, I can fully understand, the only country which has a positive view of the TPPA of all the TPP countries is Vietnam, okay? And it has had a lot to do with the deteriorating relations between China and Vietnam, okay? Vietnam feels that it is in the armpit of China, not a nice place to be, yeah? And so, you know, they are looking for alternatives, and you can understand. Also, additionally, until 41 years ago, they were at war. So there is still some residual stuff which makes access, you know, less, more difficult than for a country like Malaysia, for example. So Vietnam, for these reasons, and because it is the lowest cost producer among all the TPP countries, is very likely to benefit a great deal. Where the growth is going to come from Malaysia, the benefits, because Malaysia is supposed to be the second largest beneficiary of the TPPA, I have no idea. I have no idea. But according to the bank, the World Bank, Vietnam is supposed to get additional 8% over 15 years, and Malaysia is supposed to get additional 6%. But if it is yet another textiles thing, I would tell you it is the emperor's new clothes. Okay? So I would suggest that we be much more prudent. At the same time, we have to be pragmatic, keep our long-term development objectives in mind, look very carefully at whether it is really all that worthwhile to be associated with the so-called 21st century mega trade deal, which, and also I think we have more than a year left to look very carefully at this, and I do think that it is still possible to stop this in its tracks, but it will require a heroic public effort, unprecedented. And this is why I feel that it is very important for people to better understand what the TPPA is about. The document itself is 6,350 pages long. Okay, so I don't expect any of you to read it all. I have not read it all. In fact, it's so thick, you can use it as a pillow after falling asleep reading it. Okay, so, you know, but it is a very serious matter. It is a serious matter because it not only affects us, but it also affects future generations and the future of the country. So thank you very much for your interest. And
my name is Khairul Anwar Abdullah, his old schoolmate. He used to direct plays, and I used to be the protagonist. But by way of a little anecdote, we did Chips with Everything by Sir Arnold Wesker in 1969. Subsequently, Jomo met Sir Arnold, and Sir Arnold was absolutely flabbergasted that a little military all-boys college out in the boondocks in the Commonwealth could produce a three-act play that he thought university students had difficulty in doing. I say this simply because nobody told us it was impossible, and therefore we did it. Today, in Malaysia, too many people tell us that this is impossible, that is impossible. And, you know, I have gradually become very skeptical of some of the remarks that have been made by professional economists of the blue water or the white water, you know, variety, about what Malaysia can or cannot do. Now, Jomo will know that I was a bit more dyed in the wool 30 years ago in the economic planning unit. And by that, I mean more mainstream Keynesian, having dealt with some of the earlier CGE models that he's been talking about, together with the World Bank and the Sussex. But having tried to get a year and a half ago some of the details of the modeling, it was absolutely not available to people like me. Not that I'm an econometrician anymore. I've never been one. Probably a huge outlier at this point in time. But at least I would be able to look at a CGE model and say what assumptions go into it. Now, that is by way of commentary. The question is as follows. Malaysia needs a major reset in terms of its structural deficiencies. And they're all over the place. The best, perhaps, commentary that I can make is that if you look at Malaysian corporates, they have been distributing dividend to the extent that no sensible, well, don't quote me, but this is a public forum, so I'll say it. in a manner that no sensible corporate would do. And by the way, Sime Darby is now under watch list sometimes, right? So you can get the idea of what I'm getting at. We need a major reset, not only at the corporate level. We all need a major reset in health policy, and we need a major reset in education, among others, and competitiveness. And it goes on. How would the TPPA, if implemented in Malaysia, add or detract to our present structural woes? Sorry, long question, but I think he understands me.
I think we'll take a few questions and then allow Jomo to answer. Second question from Gamini there.
Thank you, Helen. My question is on the modeling that was reported by the speaker. Sorry, my name is Gamini Herath from the School of Business. I hope if you can't see me, then I think I'll stand. My question is on the modeling processes that are reported by the speaker, the Peterson study, World Bank study, and also the study by the United Nations. My concern is all those studies fall far short of what could actually be accepted as credible, because there are very serious impacts that are actually put upon agriculture in the third world in terms of water quality, in terms of air pollution, water pollution, etc. You take Malaysia itself, you take oil palm, enormous amount of damage to the environment because of the heads. You take India, 25 million tube wells. They're digging water deeper and deeper in order to sustain agriculture, but most of them contain arsenic. 35% of the water wells in Bangladesh have arsenic. You can't even drink from those things. I don't know to just multiply any of these things, but the story is the same in all these countries, and these things have been known for a very, very long time. Of course, it's very difficult to identify the cost of these things, but analysts are quite happy to ignore all these things and come up with this, all these different studies and say, our study is a little bit better than this study, and this study is better than a little study. But if you consider all those damages, this is not very good. Even I can't hear. If you consider all those damages as costs, include them in a benefit cost analysis, all those studies, the Peterson study, World Bank, and the United Nations, you'll end up with very serious negative figures. It is time that everyone rises to this occasion, not to produce any more figures saying they are credible, and include all those things in analysis, otherwise nobody will believe any of those figures.
Thank you. There is a question from the Slido system.
So I'll be fielding a few questions from Slido. I'll start with the most popular one right now. Macroeconomics-wise, how will the TPPA impact the export power of SMEs in the emerging sectors of Malaysian market, particularly in terms of competitive advantage? And if I could, just a second one, a more also quite popular here. Is TPPA a political bloc to exclude China rather than an economic one?
Thank you. I think they're enough for you to start off with.
Thank you very much. Let me try to take the questions in reverse order, if I may. First, the question of whether it's a political bloc. I think President Obama was very forthright about it. In his last State of the Union message about 10 weeks ago, he said, with the TPP, we write the rules, not China. That's the only thing he said about the TPP. And mind you, the TPP has been touted as his major foreign policy priority for 2016. He devoted 38 seconds to it, and that was the most important line. Okay, so there's very little doubt. But the U.S. has been smarting ever since many of its allies flocked to join the AIIB, the Asian Investment Infrastructure Investment Bank, and against their advice. This was a way it's a kind of petty, yeah, that you know, it's like little kids fighting over, you know. But unfortunately, the level of the quality of international politics has really deteriorated very considerably. But whatever it might be, the stakes are very important, and I think we cannot ignore them. On the first question from the Slido, one of the consequences of having competition policy, unintended consequences of having competition policy implemented in this country, is that you basically are trying to keep the concentration index down in the country itself. So the result is that you basically discourage countries from having too much market power in the domestic market, and you basically constrain that kind of growth. Now, the results can be quite mixed, okay? It can have many consequences, but the effective result of it within this context could well be that for countries other than the US and perhaps Japan, it would be extremely difficult, even for a medium-sized or large corporation in Malaysia, to actually become internationally competitive in this kind of environment. Because you have been constrained in the past from greater position of market dominance, and so you have not been able to grow, and you're also there have been very few incentives to become internationally competitive abroad. One of the great successes of the Northeast Asian countries was what I called effective protection conditional on export promotion. So with firms being protected temporarily on condition that within a certain time period, they were required to export at least some of their products. So some of the older people in the audience are old enough to remember, say, something like the beginning of LG video tapes. You remember when they first came on, they were considered to be inferior to Sony and so on and so forth. Okay, and you bought them because they were cheaper. Okay, you bought them basically because they were cheaper. But the effect of having to compete abroad was that you basically have to be cost competitive. At the same time, you have to have a certain degree of quality to be acceptable in foreign markets. Okay, there has never been a significant incentive for Malaysian firms to develop in that fashion. And this is why I think Malaysian firms, generally speaking, will be particularly not in a terribly great position when things open up much more. Now, competitive advantage means many things to many people. So I prefer not to comment on what the notion of competitive advantage means. It was originally a very useful way of thinking about. Let me put it this way. Okay, when you think of an economic surplus, you can think of it in many different ways. If you want to, but an economic surplus in a standard conventional economic framework, you would talk about it as a kind of rent. Okay, that rent can be a Schumpeterian rent where it is a reward for innovation. It can be a different type of rent. It can be a producer surplus. It can be a consumer surplus, and so on and so forth. You know, now basically, competitive advantage is a way of trying to ensure that a firm captures as much rent as possible. Okay, so it's very different from the kind of thing. So when Michael Porter talks about competitive advantage, there is no assumption which you have in Ann Kruger's work of that once you have a rent, there will be rent-seeking behavior which will dissipate that rent away. I'm sorry to get into something which is slightly technical, but it's important to clarify this particular point in relation to this question. The gentleman who raised the question about sustainable development, I think what you say is absolutely essential. It's not the kind of thing I was intending to get to discuss today, but I think what we have now, particularly with the adoption of sustainable development goals, is a greater imperative to try to look at the at our lives, our the entire ecosystem, if you will, in a much more integrated fashion, where it could still be anthropocentric, but it would still it has to be much more integrated. The traditional economic analysis tends to look at environment, etc., as externalities. And so your point is a good reminder of that, but this is not the time to go and discuss the different types of methodologies for how to go about doing this kind of analysis. Finally, my old and dear friend Khairul Anwar has made a very important point as well, which I think you will find that among the Malaysian chattering classes, if you will, and I say this with respect rather than in a dismissive way, people who talk about what's going on in the country and so on and so forth, for a very important and influential segment of them, there is a hope. I'm not referring to Kainal here, but among the people he and I often deal with, there is a great hope that somehow or other the reforms which are going to be required to comply with the TPPA requirements are going to be beneficial for the country, improve Malaysian governance, and so on and so forth. My only response is that is wishful thinking. That is really wishful thinking. But I think the underlying point which leads people to these kinds of concerns is a very important point. Why are people so frustrated? Why do people feel the need for very major structural reforms, and they feel almost helpless that they do not see any light at the end of the tunnel? They do not see any kind of conceivable political, social, or economic or governance process which will somehow bring about the needed changes. So I think that is a very, very important reminder about the need for us to really bring to press very hard that ultimately we need to go beyond a mere rejection of the TPPA. You need to basically think about the kinds of processes which will bring about the kind of reset which he alluded to, which is woefully needed for the country, and which I think many of us, all of you, by your interest in this discussion and your presence here, are obviously very concerned about. And I think that in itself is hopeful. And I do hope that we have a much much broader base discussion, because I think for far too long we have often dealt at the level of the phenomena of people's grouses and very legitimate grievances, but we have not begun to try to think about what it will take to try to fundamentally reset so that we can get off to, a new start, which the nation badly needs. Thank you.
Thank you. There's time for more questions. You first.
Hi, good evening. My name is Zainal Aman Shah. I work for InvestKL. We are a government investment promotion agency. First, a quick commentary and then a question. Commentary is, I think this has been an excellent session. Might have been interesting to balance a discussion. I think an important discussion like this always warrants balance. So maybe in the future, it would be great to see Dr. Jomo next to a World Bank person, and that might be a very healthy and interesting debate, just to provide some balance into the equation. My question is, when Dr. Jomo, when you talk about there is no incentive, okay? So I just want to explore that and ask a question. When you talk about access to market, imagine if I'm a local company and I'm just playing in the Malaysian market, 30 million people. Isn't there an incentive for me as a company to be able to access a much bigger market that the TPP, 12 member countries, allows me to participate? That's a much bigger market of a 30 trillion combined GDP market. Now, isn't that alone enough of an incentive for me to look in a positive manner? Now, reverse the scenario where if Malaysia doesn't participate in the TPP and the rest proceed, now, doesn't that basically diminish my competitiveness and my access to market? That means I will basically be playing in a much smaller 30 million market space as opposed to a much bigger market.
Thank you. Great question. Up there.
Dr. Jomo, an excellent presentation. My name is Alfred. Now, some of these points or my question actually would have been covered in some ways. I think it's wide-ranging set of comments that we had. But my question actually, I would zoom in on actually the purported gains that the Malaysian government has actually made, from what I understand, on the concessions that they have had for GLCs or state-owned enterprises to be somewhat excluded, or should I use a perhaps more stronger word, protected from this TPPA. Is this in spirit of TPPA? And is there any way that this sets a collision course for these GLCs sometime down the road against like where you mentioned or you brought up ISDS? And the other point is, I think for many Malaysians, SMEs, for example, are they looking at, it's already difficult in many ways, trying to operate in an environment, present environment, where the government is actually so much in business. Now, when you open up, you have a block, a GLCs, which are somewhat protected, and you have the entry of the big boys. How does, or how would we stand in this respect? Thank you.
I think there's one more question there.
Thank you so much for your speech. My name is John. I just have quick questions. How would you respond to the general argument that if everyone else is in it, we cannot afford to be left out? And my follow-up question is, what actions can I take to influence the implementation process of TPPA? Thank you.
Thank you. Is there a question on?
Yeah, hi. My name is Adlan from Shell Malaysia. So we have one chapter in TPP which is called Final Provisions that sort of dictate how it come into force and how you can amend certain things in the TPP. It also says there's certain process that you can take to withdraw from being in TPP. So, you know, with your knowledge of the content, how legit it is, or do you have 1,001 processes that you need to take to withdraw or amend certain things in TPP? Thank you.
Okay, I have Mahendran and then the Slido question. Mahendran first.
Thank you for the comprehensive talk. You talked about China, and I think, you know, as you mentioned, China is excluded from the TPP. And clearly, you know, China is a very important market for Malaysia and ASEAN. And one of the benefits of China being out of the TPP is we're starting to see a lot more FDI from China into the ASEAN region. So at least if you look at the last quarter, the flows have been quite substantive. So that in itself is a benefit because the excluded parties would want to play in the game, and they want to be part of the TPP member countries. The drawback is that it's a double-edged sword, where you have a lot more Chinese companies coming here with better technology, cheaper technology, that could put tremendous pressure on Malaysian firms. Just wanted to hear your perspective, both sides.
Okay, I will take one or two questions from Slido before I invite Jomo to respond.
I think this question might have been answered earlier. Local business associations, such as Chinese Chambers in Industry in Malaysia, are saying that TPPA is good for SMEs. Do you agree and why? Okay, and the second question here, it's also quite popular. Will the TPPA survive past the Obama era, especially with the possibility of having a President Trump in the horizon?
I was waiting for the Trump question.
Thank you for these questions. I'll have to be much briefer than I was in the first round, so excuse me for that. I'll take them in order since I have all my notes here. Zainal's point ignores what are called transactions costs, startup costs. It's not all that easy just to move into a market. There are many, many things which need to be done. And they're very, very specific to how you're moving into a particular market, what you're doing, and so on. Let me give you a couple of instances where I do think that the Malaysian government got it right. Okay? Malaysia was not a major producer of palm oil 40 years ago. 40 years ago. It became a major producer of palm oil as rubber prices went down. During the 60s, and then from the early into the 70s, and Malaysia became increasingly important producer of palm oil, and there was a great desire to start refining palm oil, and Malaysia started and a few companies started refining the palm oil, what happened was that there was tariff escalation in the European market. So the more refined the palm oil was, the higher the tariffs they faced entering the European market. Eventually, what the Malaysian government did was to impose duties, countervailing duties, so that the more crude oil the less refined the oil, the higher the export duty imposed. Okay, so in an attempt to sort of level the playing field. Okay, even after that, what happened was that there was further tariff escalation in Europe. So Malaysian palm oil couldn't enter you. So what did the government do? You had a collective action problem. There were about half a dozen or so large plantation companies, but none of them would really do anything, because there was always, there was always, the first mover would always have to bear more costs. Okay, so nobody else was nobody would move. So what happened was that the Malaysian government started negotiating, first with India, later with the Soviet Union, then with Pakistan, and eventually with China, all countries which had foreign exchange constraints at that time, and basically started doing what we now call barter deals. Okay, so palm oil became very popular and very widely used, and that is how Malaysian palm oil developed. Now, the Malaysian engineers have always been very well trained, at least in that of that generation, but they were always consigned to doing maintenance work. Okay, nothing very serious beyond maintenance. With the palm oil industry, many of them, mechanical engineers, chemical engineers, and so on especially, developed their skills. And within a decade, Malaysia became the most efficient and cost-competitive refiner in the world. Okay, this is the real story, a real success story of Malaysian industrialization during this period. A story which has never been sung, because
you know, everybody was focused on electronics. But this was something which is a remarkable story. Now, there were a number of things which happened which made all this possible, including the buying over of these plantation firms, bringing them back from London, and so on and so forth. So these were very, very considerable achievements. But it underlines the fact that you moving into a market is not child's play. You just don't move into a market just because there's a huge market out there. Otherwise, we would see lots and lots of firms doing that. I'm not suggesting that the story of palm oil applies across the board, but I think it's very important for us to remember that there are costs. Economists sometimes call them transaction costs. They call them, first mover costs, and so on and so forth. There's a lot of free riding, you know, and so on. But if not, the government could have done it. You couldn't, the private companies were not going to do it. And they certainly didn't do it. So I think, I don't want to exaggerate the role of government, but I think it's very important for us to remember that there are, unfortunately, market access is not as easy as one might assume in a textbook type of situation. Moving very quickly to Alfred's point about the, you ask a lot of questions, and Malaysian government gave the negotiators a limited number of things they wanted to prioritize, and so those things were carved out. I do not think that the carve out on GLCs was bad. In fact, if you look at GLCs are a very, very important part of many very successful economies. People often take, there was, for decades, I was, the world was waiting for the weight of the state-owned enterprises to bring down the Chinese economy. Nothing of that sort happened. It's all rubbish. But it was contrary to the ideology which was held by a lot of the people doing the kind of economic analysis. Likewise, with the so-called Chinese financial system collapsing and so on and so forth. So we find a lot. Look at which is the most efficient steel producer in the world today. For the last two decades, it has been Bao Steel, in what used to be a suburb of Shanghai. Before that, it was POSCO, the Pohang Steel Corporation, which the World Bank refused to finance, okay, when it was proposed by the Korean government before that. And so the question is how you run these state-owned enterprises. There's nothing inherently bad. Look at the Singapore economy. Okay, whatever you might think about the Singapore government, the fact is that the state-owned enterprises, by and large, are quite well run. Okay. And I can assure you that Singapore would not have had the kind of technological edge which it enjoys today, if not for the role of many of these people who were very important, who worked around people like the late Dr. Goh Keng Swee and so on and so forth. So I think it's very important for us not to get carried away with the fact that, unfortunately, many GLCs undoubtedly are being abused in many parts of the world, including in our own country. But it does not mean that you therefore throw the baby out with the bathwater. Chang says we cannot afford to be left out. Well, I'm not sure what we are going to be left out of. You know, I honestly don't know what we are going to be left out of. Thailand is an even more open economy than Malaysia is. And you don't see Thailand scrambling to get on board the TPPA. The Philippines is much closer to the US in terms of political orientation. But the Philippines has never insisted on being part of the TPPA. So are these all stupid people, and are we the only smart ones in Southeast Asia? I think we should, I think there's a bit more to it perhaps than we might want to think. So I think this first mover advantage and cannot afford to be left out kind of arguments, I think are perhaps a little misspecified. There might be certain things we may well lose out on. But on balance, is that worth it? And I think that case has not yet been made. Adlan made the point about withdrawal costs, about withdrawal. Yes, there is a clause, but let's face it, you amend 18 laws, you're going to get stuck in a situation with those 18 laws, 18 sets of laws, and it's, you know, you've already caused the damage, okay? And I think you cannot presume that withdrawal is a no costless option. Yes, you have the right to withdraw, you know, but it's not a costless option. Okay, I'm a member of a couple of clubs which I think I regret joining. You know, but you know, you also weigh the consequences of withdrawing, right? So I think one should be very, very careful about this this argument. Professor Mindran's point is an important point, but I'm not sure how much of this Chinese investments here are because of the TPP. You know, they may well be, okay. And I would concede that point, if it is true, okay. But let's I think it's not insignificant that Malaysian solar panels were being blocked from entry into the US, completely against WTO rules, but they were being blocked. It was claimed that Malaysia was subsidizing the solar panels. I mean, any solar panel manufacturers here, the few whom I've been able to talk to were all shocked to hear that they were recipients of any subsidies from the Malaysian government. You know, it was completely done because of various political considerations, because certain very powerful unions in the US both with solar panels as well as with wind turbines. Malaysia doesn't export wind turbines, but they were quite uncompetitive compared to the American ones, were quite uncompetitive compared with the Chinese products. And so they blocked the Chinese ones first, and then they blocked the Malaysian ones first later. Now, there is absolutely no reason why this cannot be reimposed, because, you know, this was a decision made by a court. And if you look at the fine print, there are even decisions. Is it a state government in the U.S. has much more leeway compared to state governments in this country? State governments can pretty much do whatever they want under the TPPA. But it means next to nothing in Malaysia except for Sabah, Sarawak and Terengganu, where they have some significant significantly more fiscal resources. It doesn't mean very much. In the US, look at the state of California or the state of New York. You know, ASEAN as a whole is smaller than the state of California. So I think when you're talking about equivalence, we are drawing false equivalences by negotiating. You seem to have a level playing field. The words all sound very equal, okay? But we are talking about very, very different things. And that's why I made the point earlier about competition. But I would take your point that there may well be investments which would be located in Malaysia because of this TPPA advantage. Finally, the Slido questions. I don't know which Chinese Chamber of Commerce actually said that it's good for SMEs. I don't see the president of the SME Association saying that it's going to be good for SMEs. If anything, it is other people who are claiming it's going to be good for SMEs. But the SME people have never, ever said. They are very, very concerned. In fact, it is generally considered that the SMEs are going to be the biggest victims of the TPPA. So I'm very curious, I can't remember who asked that question, but I would be very curious as to which Chinese Chamber of Commerce ever made such a statement. But it's a very curious state of affairs we are in this country, where we have people who are not manufacturers, who speak for manufacturers, and I suspect people who are not associated with SMEs who speak for SMEs. So anything can happen. Thank you.
We are already past 7:30, 7:45. If there are one or two final questions. Okay, I see two hands. The lady in the middle there, and then the gentleman.
Hi. Given that this TPPA is primarily politically motivated, do you agree that the counter movement in these 2 years should be political as well? It can't be entirely civil. In that regard, what possibilities do you see, for example, China can deal with the other countries to in order to forge an anti-TPPA partnership, for example?
Last question.
Thank you, Professor Jomo. I think that's one of the best explanations I got on TPPA so far. But I think you ended by saying that there needs to be a lot of public voice to make the government have a rethink, which I think is going to be difficult because I think the parliament has made a very interesting decision not only to sign, as you correctly say, but also to rectify. And the reason why I say it's going to be difficult is based on three observations. One is a local think tank, ICIS Malaysia's analysis of the TPPA, although they did raise some concerns on certain chapters, but the overall analysis seems to be very favorable. The second is there's a deafening silence, really from the academics in Malaysia, on this whole issue of TPPA, of course, with the exception of Prof. Goodyal from UM, who writes once in a while. But there's really no science policy interface in reality happening in this country on such an important issue because you're correct, it's beyond trade. It's environment, it's biodiversity, it's patent, it's life forms, it's biotechnology. The third is, while when we were discussing the FTA a few years ago, a bilateral agreement with the US, the biggest concern was the Bumiputra issue. It was very strong there that there's not going to be any preferential treatment. But once the TPPA came on as a visible document, the big majority of Malaysians were quietened or were quite comforted by MITI's assurance that the Bumiputra rights will prevail. With that, there was total, and now Malaysians in the newspaper are looking at other issues. So I'm really concerned that TPPA probably has sort of reached a sunset in discourse in Malaysia. Your views on how to churn a rethink. Thank you.
Well, having been back 3 months, I certainly would not... do not feel well placed to provide any advice on how to move forward. But I do think that we have a situation where there's a great deal of disquiet. There are many people, including Barisan National MPs, who basically voted a lot because the whip was exercised. And although the opposition didn't exercise the whip, they pretty much voted, even though I know that there are some opposition MPs who are actually quite keen on the TPPA. But I think a lot of this comes from wishful thinking. You know, you remember Khairul Anwar's first question. You know, people hope that somehow or other the logjam will be broken by the TPPA. You know, there's a lot of wishful thinking because people feel so hopeless and helpless, you know, that they just are hoping that something will give and some things will improve. I think, so a lot of it comes partly out of, I can't avoid the term, ignorance, and that's why I think it will only come about through popular education, you know. And this I think is unfortunately the only way things will change. What this will eventually entail, going back to the lady's question, obviously it will involve political matters as well. But I think the political, because the political is often associated with partisan politics in this country, is not terribly helpful. I think what we need is a greater awareness about the implications of what all this means. Just take two things alone. One, you take the question of the price of drugs and the availability of drugs, and take the other point, the point of public health being basically, that the ability, that the willingness, the likelihood that the government's acting in the public interest is going to be severely compromised with the ISDS. I think those two things alone and if you think through the implications of it, I suspect that most ordinary people would find this quite unacceptable. And I don't think you require a big CGE model or some other model people, any thinking people, and I believe that all Malaysians are thinking people, would respond to what they believe to be in the public interest. I think the question of the other issues raised are true, but I don't think that in themselves. I mean, people are quite cynical. You go to a lot of people of ordinary Malays, and you come and tell them about this is necessary for the Bumiputra interest and so on. People are looking beyond that kind of thing, you know. Of course, they don't want anything which would undermine the popular Malay interest, you know. But at the level of what, you know, a few rentiers are looking out for themselves, I don't think people associate them with that anymore. I think, speaking after having been away for 11 and a half years, that's one of the better things I find which has happened in this country. There are many things I find very, very, I despair about many things, but that's one of the better things I find. I find that people are not, you know, just being responsive to this kind of baser interests. And I would say the same thing not only of Malays. I would say the same thing about non-Malays as well. You know, this kind of knee-jerk kind of response you could get about appealing to ethnic interests, I think, are probably less deep today than they used to be. So let me stop here. I think it's getting rather late, and I think many of you have other things to attend to. So I want to thank you all for your presence. I want to thank Monash University of Malaysia for kindly inviting me to be here today. And I do hope that all of you will continue to keep the public interest in your minds, if not in your hearts, and that we will all work for a better Malaysia. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Jomo. Thank you very much. That concludes the first public lecture in the Sir Jomo Monash series, and I'd like to thank you all for being a wonderful audience. Good night.